fine.
Good afternoon, everybody. We've just come to the hyena den. I was trying to get here before you joined us, and so I drove a little carelessly in here. There is the hyena mum. And I'm hoping she's going to bring her babies out. Now, you are on a live safari here in the middle of the Kruger National Park, well, actually the western fringes thereof. We're in a little place called Juma, which is a small piece of a slightly larger piece of a collection of private farms called the Sabi Sand, all part of the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park. And if you're watching us for the first time, you heard me correctly, live, all the way from Africa. It's wonderful to have you with us. You can talk to us at any stage, hashtag Safari Live, or questions at wildearth.tv if you're on the email. No phone calls. The Postal Service of South Africa has now been on strike for nigh on 2 years, so don't bother to send us any letters. My name is James Henry. On camera today, Viam. There we go, Viam. Well done. Viam washed his hair today, so it's quite sort of all over the place. It's quite impressive, really, for those of us who don't have hair. Of course, that's a source of jealousy. Enough about that. On the other vehicle today, Brent Leo Smith with his long locks, and he's being filmed by the equally long-locked David Eastall. Yes, that is a real name, Eastall. And the final control, Rebecca, is in my ear, and Louise is twiddling the knobs. Let's have a look at the hyena. So, like I say, live we are. And this hyena den we know, we've been here many times before, and our little special clan of hyenas, if you want to know a little bit more about them, there's a wonderful Facebook group called the Hyenas of Juma and Arethusa, which will tell you everything you need to know about the hyenas of Juma and the property to the west of us, Arethusa, where we do traverse. Unfortunately, their den is not in a piece of land that we can go to, so we've never seen that den. But this den moves from time to time. This is a low-ranking female, and so most of the clan is probably not here all the time, but she's just given birth to two little babies. We've seen them twice, and they've popped out, and then they've put their heads back inside. So I'm not sure if we're going to see them or not. I think we'll sit here just for 3 or 4 minutes, and then we'll leave her, and we'll probably try and come back again. Now, just an update for those of you who are concerned about Sindile. Sindile, our 20-month-old male
leopard, has been detected.
After his rabies scare, he has no rabies. He's got a collar on him. He was last pinged, his collar pinged him, in the middle of the Biffleswick cut line, which is the middle of the northern boundary of Juma, where we traverse, just north. So, and no one's seen him for about 2 or 3 days. So we're going to head along there, see if we can pick up some of his tracks. Likewise, lionesses from yesterday evening were knocking about this area yesterday evening. We didn't find them this morning. We think maybe they might have killed something. They were certainly trying when we left them, so maybe they're around here too. We're in between two roads, one off to the right-hand side of your screen and one off to the left-hand side of your screen. It's very difficult when I'm facing the wrong way. And in between the two roads is a series of drainage lines or dry riverbeds that are very difficult to get into and out of. And so those lions could easily have gone in there and be undetected. So we'll have a knockabout and see if we can find them. Otherwise, they're probably off towards Biffleswick Dam, which is toward the north and east. And north and east is to the left-hand side of your screen, i.e. my right shoulder. There we are. I don't think these little babies look like they're going to come out. They would come out if she put her head into the den and called them out. I think they're probably sleeping. They could also be suckling while she's lying there, but because she's so sleepy, I think they're probably doing the same thing. So I'm going to suggest we come back a little bit later. Let's carry on and see what else we can see. Now, this, of course, is the spotted hyena. And I must apologize for the state of my microphone, which is rather ridiculous, I have to say, but that, I'm afraid, is the fault of Jean Dre, who, I don't know, he's replaced the little sponge with a giant busby. I think he must have pilfered it off a guard at Buckingham Palace when he was last in London. So if you find or hear of a Buckingham Palace guard missing his busby, you know where it is. It is now affixed to the front of my jersey. But at least my sound is wind-free, isn't it? Other than the wind coming out of my voice, of course. Not so, Via? Crystal clear, crystalline, marvellous, excellent. Brent Leo Smith is heading towards Cheetah Plains, which is to the far east of us. And he is not looking for a Singapore noodle stand there. He is looking, hopefully, for Quarantine. Quarantine, a male leopard, now 3 and a bit years old, who was there this morning. Magnificent looking fellow, very chilled out, very calm, and hopefully we'll get some, spend some time with him. And his father, of course, has come back, which is wonderful. That's Mvula. Well, we think it's his father. And Mvula's been knocking about here, but still he's not marking territory. He's most certainly kind of avoiding conflict with other males, and he was last seen on a warthog kill on Arethusa. We could think about going across there, but I haven't heard anything further about that. It's not a bad thought, actually. I want to just check and see if we can't find Sindhila first, and maybe those lions. That would be very nice indeed. Also, I know that many of you will... some of you will be new viewers as a result of our TV special that we did on National Geographic Wild, or Nat Geo Wild, I think it's called, not National Geographic Wild. And when I talk of, when I say you can ask us questions or send us comments, you really can about anything to do with Africa and South Africa as well. Lots and lots of misconceptions about this place, about the continent, about our country. And we'd really like to clear them up, because I think a lot of people would like to come and visit this area, but they're not very concerned about, I mean, from what they'll eat to security to disease. I mean, I know that our tourism took a major dive with the Ebola outbreak in Liberia. And what many people fail to understand is that Liberia, where the Ebola virus took hold, this is more than 3,000 miles from where we are now. There were no Ebola cases in South Africa. There were some in the United States, however. So there were more Ebola cases in the United States than there were in South Africa. So that's just one of the things. You know, a lot of people cancelled their holidays because they thought, well, Africa, everything must be close by. Everyone's going to get Ebola, and it just isn't so. So any questions you have, it is the most wonderful continent to come and visit. So if you're worried about anything, let us know what those worries are, and we shall try and dissuade you of them and encourage you to come and visit the world's possibly most ancient source of human civilization, and certainly one of the most ancient wildernesses in the world. Now, we're popping up to the northern boundary here. We're on a road called Mvubu Road, which means Hippo Road in Zulu. Why on earth it should be named after a Zulu name when there are no Zulus in this area? Well, that's just very difficult to understand. The local language of this area is called Shangaan or Xitsonga, and it's a very beautiful whistling kind of a language. Many whistling sounds in it, as opposed to the clicks, which are much more which people associate much more with African languages from South Africa. Thank you, Andrea. Nice question from you about malaria. Is malaria a concern? Well, Andrea, malaria does occur in the Kruger National Park, absolutely. Have I ever had it? No. How long have I lived here? About 12 years, never had it here. Do people sometimes get it? Yes, very odd cases. VMP Ariel's down, I'm afraid. Yes. So it is a concern for some. I mean, Brent, who's had malaria 28 times, has never caught it from here. He walks past a mosquito, and if it's got malaria, he will get it. And so it's really a pretty low-risk area. Nothing to worry about. And these days, you know, if you do get malaria, if there's a, you know, there is a chance that you'll get it, then it's very easily treatable. And you can, of course, take prophylactics, which will stop you getting it. They're highly, almost 100% effective. So yes, a small risk if you come here. At this time of the year, almost no risk at all because there's no water around? Very nice question. Thank you for that, Andrea. Now, to the left of us is Biffle's Hook. That's an area we can't go, but the animals you can see are free to come and go as they please. There's no fence along here. Now, Brent Leo Smith has made his way to Cheetah Plains. Let's go and find out from him what he's going to achieve this afternoon.
Hi, I'm Brent. Welcome to Safari Live. I've got Dangerous Dave, part of the long-haired duo for the afternoon on Wendy. And, of course, on the Sunrise Safari, we saw a favorite leopard of a lot of ours, the quarantine young male. So now I'm really hoping he hasn't moved too far and we're going to be able to find him again on the Sunset Safari. I'm worried that elephants might have chased him from his termite mound. So we're going to start looking very carefully for tracks. And we are quite close to the northern boundary of Cheetah Plains. That's where we had him this morning, lying right up next to Three in a Row Pan. Now, of course, there could be great luck, and he might have caught an unsuspecting impala that came down for a drink. But I just want to double check the tracks. So far, so good. Not a sign of a track, and also doesn't look like the Ellies have walked through here either. Oh, one has, but elephants, of course, make tracking leopards quite difficult. They obliterate all tracks. And of course, this water here would attract elephants throughout the day. So we must keep an eye out on other termite mounds close by. Might have just maneuvered to termite mounds. But I am hoping he hasn't moved too far. Remember, we are live, so we're searching for a beautiful young male leopard live in the middle of the African bush. And also, if you want to know a bit more about leopards or that leopard in particular, you can use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter to ask us a question, or you can send us an email on questions@wildearth.tv. Hi, Aaron. Aaron says we're certainly not short on leopard sightings at the moment. May we have a recap? Of course you may. So let's... Friday. Let's start on Saturday. Well, what are we on now? Wednesday. Yes, I think that's a big enough period. Saturday produced both Sindila, Shadow, and Shadow's cub, as well as Mvula. And Sunday was Sindila. Monday, no leopards on Monday. Tuesday, no, Monday, I think Mvula in the morning. Monday, Mvula in the morning. And in the afternoon. And then Tuesday, had Karula's little cubs. And today, Wednesday, we've had quarantine. He is not on top of his termite mound, so I'm probably going to have to do, and there have been quite a few elephants. I'm just going to have a quick look around. We're going to move down there and check on other termite mounds in the area. He is fond of a good termite mound, young quarantine. Hopefully, we'll be able to see his tracks. They haven't all been obliterated by Ellies. So he was atop of this termite mound this morning. Now, which way could he have gone? So I'm going to check down towards the next road junction. And if we've got nothing there, then I'll come back and maybe take a walk around the termite mound. Just want to make sure he hasn't headed off to the west. It doesn't look like it so far. I think these are his tracks coming in because they go from the west towards the Termit Mound. So maybe he's moved off to the northeast. Let's have a look around. Now, I want to keep looking. There's quite a few big termite mounds in this area. Now, we're the first people out on Cheetah Plains, the sunset safari, so hoping to be on those tracks as quick as possible. So he doesn't come out here, and he was probably waiting for one of these little guys to pop out while he was sitting on top of that termite mound. A little male steenbokkie. And there's the female. So I was wondering if maybe during the day he might have caught one of the pair we see here regularly, but it looks like they're both fit and well. So let's carry on. Now, hello, Julia. Julia in Houston is wondering if I've ever been to the Salou Game Reserve. I, in fact, lived there for quite a few years, Julia. I used to run a 300,000-acre concession in the Southern Salou, where we used to do big game walking safaris. So I've spent a lot of time in the Salou. I think the longest period I spent without leaving was about 9 months. Carefully through here. Now there's a big game path that goes from the pan to our repeater, so I might even check around there. So I was based in the Salou on the junction of the Lukula and Luwego rivers, and we actually built up those camps from scratch, put in roads. We took over a hunting area and turned it into a big game walking safari area. Very, very beautiful part of the world. Lots and lots of wild dogs. So, of course, I was quite happy. And I even got a Swahili nickname while I lived there, which was Mbamwitu, which is wild dog, because apparently I could get as excited as a wild dog, according to the guys I worked with there. But on that note, let's go see what Commander Bond is up to.
Right, Viam and I have come to the worst road on Juma. It is the worst road simply because of its current position directly through a steep line, which is fine. It's just a little bumpy, and it's a good place to come and look, especially in the summer months, you can see, for buffaloes. And you might find other things wallowing in these little mud wallows. So it's a good place for mud wallowing animals. Warthogs, of course, they like to wallow in the mud. It is quite chilly today. It's probably only about 16 or 17 degrees Celsius, which is about 65 degrees Fahrenheit. So quite chilly, a bit of a wind coming out of the southeast, and that is normal with the frontal weather. This kind of cloudy, gunmetal, grey sky does normally come out of the southeast, and it's quite nice to have every so often. And I know many of you, especially in the United Kingdom, for example, will be mortified by the thought of me saying, well, you know, it's quite nice to have a grey sky every so often, because I know how much you value your sunny skies. But, you know, for months on end in this area, we only have beautiful blue, deep winter skies. And every so often, it's nice to have a bit of an eerie grey sky. Now, I'm in this area because we thought maybe the lions would have come across here. Don't think anyone drove here during the course of the morning. Hello, Sandy. I'd love to know which news report it was that said Africa has a major problem with the Zika virus, which is a mosquito-borne virus, as far as I'm aware. No, Sandy, I've not heard one report of Africa having the Zika virus. I'm sure that there are one or two places. Remember, you can fit the continental United States into Africa three times. So that means that Africa is 5,000 miles long from top to bottom. United States is about, I think it's about 2,000 miles from end to end. And the area is three times less than the area of Africa. So, yes, there could be Zika virus in some places in Africa, I suppose. I haven't heard of any. And there is certainly no evidence of the Zika virus in South Africa. Certainly not an outbreak of it here in South Africa. So, no, I would say absolutely not. I'd love to know which newscast that was. And I'd love to know which part of Africa they were talking about. And that's exactly the kind of question that we need, Sandy. That's great. Thank you very much for it. Because I do think even news broadcasts, which of course we know that the media is designed around selling these days rather than the business of giving truth. And so if they can make a slightly panicked statement about Africa, well, you know, it'll get people watching. But most certainly there may be one or two cases of the Zika virus in South Africa, but I read the news regularly every single day, and I certainly haven't heard of any here. Thank you, Sandy. Great question. Brilliant stuff. That's exactly what we want to talk about. Well, we'd rather talk about lions and leopards, of course, but we need to see some first. We might be lucky. I felt like those three lionesses from last night were heading in this direction. But I have not seen them. I was kind of hoping to find them lying on the ground here eating. Debbie, you want to know what the worst disease the lions get is. Well, Debbie, it depends on the animal, really. So you know that human beings can get different kinds of diseases that don't necessarily affect animals at all. So I'd say the worst disease that animals get out here in this particular area would be rabies. Rabies can be terribly detrimental. It can be carried by some and never expressed, like the mongoose. They can carry it, but they never express the disease. And it then can get into wild populations, and that's why such care was taken with Sindile. I'd say that's one of the worst. You can have the odd anthrax outbreak every so often in very, very dry years. It's extremely uncommon, but it can happen from time to time. And, yeah, those are probably the two worst that affect the animals out here. Then the bovids, so the hoofed, cloven-hoofed animals, well, they get things like foot and mouth sometimes. They also are affected by bovine tuberculosis, which is very much a similar disease to the tuberculosis that human beings get, but just for bovids. But if they are in good condition, so if there's sufficient rain and sufficient food for them, well, it doesn't seem to affect them too badly. So those are two of the major diseases, I suppose. Malaria is still a problem for much of Africa, but not this particular country, which is quite nice. Vim, you've never had malaria, have you?
No.
So we're just looking under every bushel here, in every tree. I haven't been out for 2 days, so it's almost like re-exploring the place, relearning what's going on. So that's what we're doing. And what I really have noticed over the last 4 or 5 days has been the change in the color of the leaves. Lovely question from Gracie, aged 8. Gracie, you say some guy who fell out of a tree. I think you're talking about Steph. Steph fell out of a tree, and you say that he told you, I like to climb trees to use the telephone. Yes, well, I do. I have to. We don't have much signal, much network coverage here, Gracie. So if I want to make a phone call to my mum and dad, then I have to climb a tree. And I sit up the tree, and I talk to my family from there. That is very true, Gracie, but I do like to climb trees, you know that. Thankfully, I haven't fallen out of any of them recently. Brent and Steph have both fallen out of one recently, so I've no doubt it will be my turn soon, but hopefully I won't fall out of a tree. Thank you for that, Gracie. So like I was saying, the last 3 or 4 days, these colours, these golden colours of the winter, and you can see them out in the distance there, are starting to take over. That really is recent. It's within the last week. I'm sure it's been happening slowly, but I think it's happened as the solstice has happened. Of course, we're going back towards summer now, aren't we, Vim? Yes, we've had the winter solstice. Late winter. Yes, we do have a late winter. I have to agree with you. I think July will be our coldest month. August will be coming out of it. Then we'll get hit definitely in September by a cold, big cold snap. And then it'll be beastly hot again for months on end. Vim, have you seen a mammal yet? No, this seems to be a recurring theme since our TV shows with me. We did see 2 buffalo and some nyala before we came live, and a bushbuck, and we thought, we'll find something. We'll find something bigger, closer to Buffelshoek Dam. Yeah, we did find something bigger. We found a broken down piece of earth moving equipment. Yeah. So, Sandy, thank you for that. You've come back to me and you've said that CNN reported that the whole of Africa had a problem with the Zika virus. I can categorically tell you that CNN is stretching the truth quite substantially there. There is a mammal, a little nyala, and her calf. So, Sandy, I wouldn't worry about it. I think the chances of you contracting the Zika virus here are smaller than the chance of you contracting it in the United States. Look at that little thing. That looks like a bit of a cut there, doesn't it, Vim? May have been set upon by a predator at some stage. But she's got through it. Very small, very sweet. Looks just like a sort of Bambi, I suppose. Isn't that lovely? But that's definitely a wound. Something is scratched along the back there. Could have been a leopard, but I mean, I find it difficult to see our little nyala calf like that. I mean, that nyala calf probably weighs, I don't know, 20 kilos, 40 pounds, 44 pounds. I find it difficult to believe that whatever leopard made that mark wouldn't have caught her. There had been something smaller, like a caracal, I suppose. Or just, you know what else it could have been? Could well have been running away from something, scratched or ran past a sharp tree or twig and scratched herself on the side. It could really have been that. Let's just have one last look there and then we'll carry on towards Buffelshoek. We must milk the sighting for everything it's got, Vim, given my luck of late. Oh, no. All right, on we go. There we go, one last look. And they like these areas. You may have noticed that we've been coming downhill for some time. And we're now into the drainage system that eventually leads up to Buffelshoek Dam. And the bush is thick, which means that it's out of this sort of nasty wind blowing from the southeast. And it means that there's some greenery to eat for these browsing antelope. And they can hide a little bit. Their camouflage is effective down here when they're being stalked by the predators. Very nice, Vim. So just hold that shot if you don't mind, VMP. That's the kind of view, that's the sort of distance we've got. That she is about twice, three times the size as the little calf there. So she's probably 60 or 70 kilograms, which is about 160 pounds. And while that very sort of chestnut colour sticks out for us, for the predators, mixed with green, it's almost invisible because they are colourblind. And they see in shades of red and green. And so that, especially with the outline broken up by those white stripes, will be difficult for a predator like a leopard or a lion to see. And the leopards and the lions are very difficult for us to see as well, aren't they, Vim? Yes, seemingly. All right, let's carry on and see if we can find some. So that's a nyala. Nyala cow and her calf. Let's ease our way through here. Checking under the bushes, over the bushes, on the termite mounds. I hate to think, I tell you, when I think about the number of kilometres I've driven around game reserves, I hate to think of the number of leopards I must have gone past just by, you know, not looking under that bush while I was looking under that bush on the right-hand side. But they just do find it so very easy to hide away. I suppose I should be more astonished by the fact that we see them at all. Hello, Roger in Florida. Nice to hear from you. My uncle's name is Roger. I'm going to assume you're not him because he lives in Cape Town. Roger, the Juma private game reserve, you want to know how big it is in miles. Well, it is in acres, 3,000 acres. Now, I don't know what that is mile by mile. I suppose I could probably work it out for you. 3,000 acres. Well, let me do it in square kilometers, and then I can convert it for you. So it's 1,200 kilometers, at least hectares. So you divide that by 100, and you get to 12 square kilometers. That's right, yes, 12 square kilometers. And 12 square kilometers in miles, you divide by 1.6. So it's almost 2. We get to roughly 8. Roughly 8 square miles is Juma. And so, I mean, you could work that out as 2 by 4 miles, if you like, but it's a bit bigger than that, it feels like. It's probably about 3.5 by 3.5 miles, something like that. 8.7 square miles, there we go. Thank you very much, Rebecca. I don't think I did too badly in my head there. And so, Roger, that's this reserve. And then about... Ooh. Hang on 1 second, Roger. Hold that thought. I thought some lion tracks, but I didn't. My eyes deceived me. Roger, we also traverse Arethusa to the west of us, which is 2,000 acres. So I'm going to say roughly 6.5 square miles. And then Cheetah Plains, where Brent is, which is about half the size of that, and so that's about 4.35 square miles. Let's head straight back across to Brent on Cheetah Plains.
Now, we found the tracks of where he came from going in. I haven't found any tracks coming out yet. So I just want to have a quick look at the Cheetah Plains pan, the only other bit of water. And I'm going to go up to the northern boundary and do a slow check there before cutting through an owl's nest, which is the road that runs through the middle of the block. I've had a look at our repeater already. So we're about to arrive out in the open. Let's have a look if we can see anything from here. Quiet looking from here. Let's see if there are any tracks. Nope. Nada. Okay, let's carry on. Head up towards the boundary with Inkoro and then check back to the west. Fingers crossed he's still here somewhere. Now, Deborah in Vancouver is wondering when he might start setting up his own territory. I think he's a couple of years off that still, Deborah. Probably he'll be big enough and strong enough and brave enough to challenge. Earliest I've heard of is about 5, normally closer to 6. Although I heard his brother started making some inroads down along the Sand River. Okay. So we're going to nearly up towards what they call Kalkol Open. And then we're going to cut off to the west. Now, on cool days like this, a lot of the animals don't need to drink as much. And, of course, they're not losing a lot of their water to evaporation or to being hot, panting. So less need for drinking, especially things like buffalo and impala and zebra. And it hasn't got warm today at all. It stayed pretty chilly all day. Quiz across this open area. Nothing here as well. Now we're gonna have to check really, really carefully for tracks along this road. It's been very windy today, so that does make the tracks a little bit harder to spot. There's also no nice light, and those creatures also make it difficult to track when they walk over them. And there are some creatures up ahead. Looks like a big herd of buffalo. Well, maybe not a big herd of buffalo, but a herd of buffalo at least. A small herd of buffalo. Got a fancy hat, that female. She's lost, broken both her sets of horns. That one there. There you go. Looks like a little bit more like a cow than normal. Now. Oh, there's a bit of an altercation. That one was chasing another. Now, they're not going to be particularly happy with this weather. Windy, it's a bad time to be a buffalo, especially if there are lions about. I don't think there are any lions too close to this lot, but they're going to be extra nervous today. You see that? Just a little bit of wind, and one jogs a little bit, and they all get a bit of a fright, and the others start jogging. A flows. You can just see the nervousness that this wind is creating. Moving across our northern boundary. And they've stopped to feed in a seep line. You can see the seep line has still got quite a bit of grass, and even though it looks like it's quite dry and dead, they will be able to get quite a bit of sustenance from it. As there will be some green parts down at the base. I'm just going to be on the game drive radio for a second. Afternoon, Andrew. There's also a small family of Nyari. They've just crossed into Nkoro to the west of Kalkor Open. There's Nkonzo going in both directions. I've done a loop through CP Pan. I'm now heading from Kalkor back towards that area, see if he's crossed north. Zelda. Hi. Zelda's in Montreal, and she's wondering, is there really going to be a cull of buffalo and hippo in the Kruger Park due to the drought? And they haven't made a definite decision yet, but that's a strong possibility. Okay, I'm going to leave this little herd of buffalo and keep checking for leopard tracks. So there hasn't been a definite decision yet, Zelda, but it's looking quite probable that there will be a large cull of buffalo and hippo in the Kruger. Fortunately, it wasn't a big herd of buffalo, so we've still got a chance to see tracks nicely. Well, the wind does make seeing tracks quite difficult, but we're just going to go very slowly. Hi, George in Missouri. George would like to know, would the buffalo, who doesn't have the horns, be more likely to be killed by a predator? Not really, George, in a herd situation like that, the oldest or the youngest are the most likely to be eaten. And she looked like she was middle of the road, maybe a little bit on the old side, but wasn't showing any sign of a lack of condition. And also, quite often in those herd scenarios, the herd will come back and help defend the buffalo that's been caught. Okay, so we're checking very carefully now. Not only are we looking at the roads, I'm still checking the termite mounds. Fingers crossed, no, we don't want any tracks on this road. Oh, it's been cool all day, so he could have actually moved quite far, but normally young male leopards like that, he might not have moved too far. Lots of termite mounds in this area. He might have been chased by the elephants, and then he might have just decided to sleep somewhere else. Checking, there's a nice termite mound through the bush there, so that's what I'm peering at. Now, every now and then we get a new viewer who would like to know, is this show really real? And Amabel, hi, it is, and we're live. So welcome to Safari Live, Amabel. And this is real. We are live in the African bush. At the moment, I'm looking for a male leopard that I saw on a live drive this morning. And he has moved off, so I've got to do some tracking. So I'm looking for his footprints at the moment. Now, Amabel, if you want to ask any other questions, you're more than welcome. Now, so far no leopard tracks, so that's really good news. We don't want any tracks in this area because this is our northern boundary. Hi, Molly. Molly said she read about a white buffalo being caught, born in Kruger National Park. That's correct. And she would like to know how rare that is. It's relatively rare, but not exceedingly so. And Molly would also like to know what causes it. It's basically a lack of melanin, the pigment melanin that's in the hair follicles. It's a genetic recessive called leucism. And leucism is what causes the animals to be white. They're not albinos. They have normal skin tone color. They just lack the melanin pigment in the hair follicles. Now, a white lion is a leucistic animal. And it's more common generally in birds. You find a lot more leucistic birds than you do leucistic animals. Now, the opposite of leucism is melanism, which is an overproduction of melanin, and that causes things like black leopards, king cheetahs, and black springbok, black impala, melanism seems to be most common in leopard and in serval, strangely enough. And lion's leucism seems to be more common. I've never actually ever heard of a melanistic lion, on the radio. FM Andrew, I'm just going to bypass and keep checking phone calls on. So, we've checked now around, and there's one little road through here we haven't checked, and so far, no tracks, so that's a really good sign. So I'm going to check through here. If nothing here, I'm going to go back to the last spot I know he was for sure and try to figure out where his tracks go amongst all those elephant footprints. So while we check Owl's Nest Road, let's go see what James is up to.
Well, James and VM have failed to find any kind of animal life, everyone, but we have got a remarkable view. So I was just mentioning how the trees had changed colour, and you can see there how they have. You can see the golden sheen on the tops of the trees all the way there to quarantine clearings. That's the clearing you were looking at there. It's a long, long way away from where we are now. Well, not that far, I suppose. Probably about, what's that, about 1.5 kilometres as the crow flies. There it is. I think that's remarkable. Are there any animals there, Vim?
Can't see any
animals there on quarantine clearings. I think that's fantastic. And just look at the grey and gold. Those are the colours of the African winter. Certainly the southern African winter. I think that's stunning. And then over above them, well, that's where Rebecca and Louise are sitting now, underneath that tower. And in the way in the distance, you can see the Drakensberg Mountains. I think that's rather special. Well done, Vim. Delightful. Good job. On we go. Hello, couple Kai. Very nice question from you about humans and what they're, you know, whether they exist here on the reserve in settlements. Well, they do, in so much as we have settlements where we live as the Wild Earth crew. There are some lion tracks here, but they don't look very fresh. So we'll just knock about here for a while and see what we can find. Bivaldrug Dam's just over here. Kapalkai, there aren't any local people living on the reserve, so there are no sort of villages on the reserve or in any of the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park, which extends east into Mozambique and north into Zimbabwe. So that's 3.5 million acres, at least hectares, 8.5 million acres, and there are no people living within that park other than park rangers, park staff, and of course the tourism staff. But on the western borders of where we live, there are about 4 million people living on the western borders of the Kruger National Park, and they're pretty poverty-stricken rural villages, where unemployment reaches 60% in some cases. What have you... well spotted, Vim. Vim spotted a pig. That's brilliant. He was terrified. A terrified pig. Everybody, that was a warthog, briefly. Our mammal list is going, Vim. It's up to 2 so far.
Right, so plenty and plenty of people living on the borders of the park, but none inside the park. And of course, being South Africa, or being any part of Africa, there is often a conflicted space, these conservation lands. And so there's always a slightly uneasy relationship between poor people living on the borders of reserves that they possibly could be using for natural resources. And so it's a constant source or articulation of poverty and conservation, and it's an interesting kind of meeting point. Here are some impala. Our list is up to three. Four. What was the fourth?
Hyena.
Oh, hyena. Yes, of course, hyena. There we go. A little herd of pregnant impala ewes. And I say pregnant because they will all fall pregnant during the dark phase of the moon in May. We're into June now. And so most of them will be gravid, carrying babies. They're the most elegant antelope, the most common we get out here, of course. And these ones are particularly successful, of course, because they're able to browse and graze. So they can eat the leaves off trees or the leaves off of grass. Very few animals are able to do that with this sort of interchangeably as easily as the impala can. I suppose just about all grazers will have the odd browse when they can. But there are a lot of chemical compounds in the leaves of trees that do not occur in the leaves of grasses, and that makes them quite difficult for many animals to eat unless they're specially adapted to it. So nice, Liam, well done. Well, we're going back towards Bivelzoek Dam now. We did check it from the other side while you were away with Brent on Cheetah Plains. Wasn't anything there, so we're just doing a loop around this way. Like I say, there were those lion tracks heading this way, coming into the block over here somewhere. Maybe we'll be lucky. I just can't get over how the vegetation has changed in the last week. I really think it's quite remarkable. That's the third flock of babblers I've... Oh, don't go away. Have you got them, Stolvium? There are two greater, at least two Cape Glossy starlings up there, which just look completely black unless they're in the light. They're actually iridescent purple and blue and green and turquoise, and that bright orange eye. Singing to you? There we go. Just standing, looking around. I love watching birds just sitting and looking. Now, you may have heard the babblers going, kick. Let's go a little bit. Oh, you know what else there is? Then there's a red-billed woodhoopoe. Oh, there's a babbler. There's an arrow-marked babbler, everybody. That's a brilliant shot. Well done. That is the arrow-marked babbler. That is two arrow-marked babblers. They live in a flock. And they're called arrow-marked, of course, because they have little arrow-shaped markings. There we go. Moved forward a bit. Look at the beautiful red around their eyes when one of them deigns to look at us. Backwards, you think? Stunning. Now, they're all fluffed out, of course, because it's a bit chilly, like I say, probably about 65, 66 degrees Fahrenheit, which isn't very cold, but this wind does drop the temperature somewhat. They're sitting in a marula tree. Very nice. Peaceful. And they live in a flock, and their little flock will sort of, if I'm not mistaken, I'm just going to check this up quickly. Their little flock is, they're communal breeders, so there'll be sort of a dominant breeding pair within the group, and the rest will probably be offspring from a previous clutch, and they'll help raise the sort of next clutch. and then go off and start their own flock. And they eat largely insects and reptiles, small reptiles, and bits of fruit, so quite Catholic diets. You have to be able to, if you're going to survive here during the winter, or any bird that overwinters anywhere, it's got to have a fairly sort of unfussy diet, because you can't eat fruit only in the wintertime, there isn't any. You can't only eat insects because there aren't that many, and you can't only eat seeds because there aren't that many either. So you've got to have a very kind of Catholic diet. And I often wonder how on earth these birds get through the winters, given how little there is by way of insect, fruit, and seed. Many zebra tracks, but no more lions seem to have come down this particular area. More down here. I'm going to drive a little bit faster to get to the dam, and then we'll see. We'll also see progress of the excavations. Oh, there's a diker running across the road, terrified. What was it terrified of, Liam? It certainly startled Franklin as it went. And the Franklin went, "Pop, pop!" No, obviously not. Is she speaking? What does she say? Oh. Hang on, Rebecca. I don't know why it's not working. Try now. Oh, gosh. There we go. I'm here, Rebecca. I'm here. No, I'm not ignoring you. Cindy, a lovely, lovely one from you. You said, do squirrels gather nuts here for the winter time, or is it not necessary because there's no snow? They do gather nuts. They gather marula nuts. And they do put them down, they put them in holes of trees, and they look after them there. And so, yes, they absolutely keep caches of food, exactly the same as squirrels do in Europe and in America. Thank you, Cindy. I've never found a cache, but I've seen squirrels putting them away. You know, running with three or four of them and then stashing them in a tree and then disappearing off again. Just go around to the front of the dam. You can see it's getting very large indeed, and when the rains come, we'll be able to do water sports, I imagine. What do you think, Vim? Do you think we'll be able to ski here? Or, yeah, perhaps we'll have boat safaris. I'm just going to go and look down here. Very nice. Vim has spotted another bird, a grey go-away bird. Which I think, they always look slightly surprised and depressed by life. I don't think this chap's very happy to be so cold. They're also not that happy, of course, because they are by far the least colourful of their family. Let me show you quickly. For Lurie. They used to be called Luries. And of course one of their kin made it onto the cover of this book. There it is there. That's a Lurie too. Let me show you the rest of them. They're all spectacularly coloured. But for the little humble grey Lurie or go-away bird, there he is. There's the Neisner one. There's the purple-crested, which you'll find in this region, just down on the rivers. And there, I would love to see that. That's called a Ross's turaco. Isn't he beautiful? Certainly makes our little humble go-away birds seem a little, drab. What do you think, Fionn?
I like them.
You like them. Yes, well, you're a kind fellow. Let's go down this way, just to check if those lions aren't lying up. They often do like to lie up at the north of the dam. But they have been doing some work here today, so I'm not sure if they'll be here. By they, I don't mean the lions, of course. Now, if I'm not mistaken, where we're parked now will be an island in the new Buffelsoek Dam. Gosh, we're going through a bit of dust of our own making. I don't see any lions here at all. Niggy's lions. I think we'll make it up the side there, Vim. I think we'll have to ramp. Hold on, everybody. VM says we'll need speed. Woo! Wasn't that fun? I really did find that quite fun. Yes, dune driving. Yeah, a little easier, though, because the sand's a bit harder. So now we can drive straight across the wall at Buffelsoek Dam, which we couldn't do before. Startling lack of animals down here tonight, and that's simply because of the weather, everybody. We know that the weather is very blustery and cold. Animals don't like that. They feel nervous, as Brent was telling you. I don't know if she's... You must just tell me if she speaks, okay, Phil? I don't want to incur her wrath. All right, I think it's time to head now down towards the south. Hello, Aqua. A nice conservation question from you. You say, do the landowners take a sort of a regular stock of their land, the grazing, etc., and then limit the number of tourists that come in and out depending? Well, yes, they do, but the effect, and certainly in the Sabi Sands, the private landowners have got an agreement as to the number of beds that they can legally have per hectare, and that's to do with the effect that they think that they will have on the land. So absolutely, and likewise in the Kruger, they do the same sort of thing. There are some dwarf mongoose, and they're running into this termite mound. I'm sure they're going to be... They're going to be hugging each other in the cold and enjoying their afternoon tea inside that termite mound. Obviously, they've decided they don't want to see us. Let's just stop here and see if we can't call them out. I will now make a small smooching sound. Oh, there's one. Can you see it, Vim? Go straight over the top of that little apple leaf tree. There's one looking at us. There. No. Is it a tree? There it is. Yes, I was not incorrect. That's mammal number 5. Very nice. That's quite sweet. And they really will go down into their mound now. And don't like the cold. And I think what you'll find is that they'll huddle together under there. And a termite mound is a brilliant place to live if you like to be insulated. It's cool in the heat, and it's beautifully warm. It'll maintain the heat for them on a day like today. So I don't think they're going to be above ground for much longer. This is a noise you have to make if you want them to come out. See how effective it is, Vim? That's utterly hopeless. Sorry about that. Right, on we go. How deeply embarrassing. Some deeply aged lion tracks here as well. I'm terrified I'm going to keep missing her, but no, I can hear her still. This is a real wintry landscape now, everyone. Jackie, you want to know what a lion den consists of. Well, yeah, it depends on the lions, really. You know, if they're very wealthy, they'll have a kitchen, three or four bedrooms, two or three entertainment areas, a good veranda, a flat screen television, and high-end entertainment system. The poorer sort live in a kind of a, well, they'd probably just hollow out a termite mound and live in there. I'm obviously being totally ridiculous. Lion dens in this area will consist largely of, like you say, thick bush, normally in a drainage line. So they've got like an overhang where, if you look around us, we're in a very ancient landscape, very few kind of rocky areas. And so ideally they'd like a cave or a sort of rocky hill where they could put the babies underneath in a cave or something like that, but this area doesn't have many of them, so they'll go into the drainage line areas, the dry riverbeds, they'll find a sort of hollowed out area, an inundated part of the bank, and put the cubs in there, especially if there's a sort of wall of vegetation there. Sometimes it is just very thick vegetation, but so often down in the riverbeds, because those seem to be the places where the thickest vegetation is found, and so the safest and warmest spots for their cubs to be are in those areas. They can also, I mean, much like if you're trying to defend yourself, if you backed up against a mountain and any threat is going to come, you know, has to attack you from the front, it's a good way for them to be able to not have to look around them all the time when they're defending the den. Very little is going to attack a lion from the front, and they can see, at least from the back, they can see everything coming from the front. So that's generally why they do it there. Nice question for that. Thank you, Jackie. I wish we could find that lion den. Now, Debbie, you're wanting to know how many of the Nkuhuma lionesses, our favorite lionesses, our sort of mainstay of lion viewing, have given birth so far. Debbie, as far as we know, it's only the Torchwood one that we can confirm has given birth. So she's got two cubs on Torchwood. We suspect that there is another den here somewhere on Juma where there's another lioness has given birth, and that's because we've seen one that's lactating, and she's certainly got very swollen nipples, and we normally only see the three lionesses together at the moment. So we're pretty sure that one of them has given birth here, but we haven't seen the cubs yet. The one on Torchwood seems to be parading her little ones out on a beautiful flat rock area. I mean, you couldn't imagine a more picturesque spot for them to be. There's a duiker, Viam. Oh, we did see another duiker. So we've got six mammals so far. See the duiker there? There it is, running away, obviously. Now that's known as a common duiker, everybody. Some people call it the grey duiker, but it's not very grey out here. It becomes greyer and greyer the further towards the Cape you go. A bit like the skies. You've seen red ones? Oh, a red duiker, or a red common duiker. Red-coloured duiker. I'll quiz Viam about that. The most beautiful one is something called a blue duiker, which is about that big. Tiny little thing. All right, while we continue to have absolutely no luck out here whatsoever, let's head across to Brent Leo Smith, who is also having absolutely luck whatsoever.
So luck doesn't seem to be working too well right this very moment. There's been so many elephants around that pan, I'm struggling to find which direction that quarantine went. I've got tracks in multiple directions, and the most fresh ones look like they're going the opposite way to the other ones, but there's nothing there. So we're going to do a little bit of a loop, but check towards the west this time rather than the east. Andrew's checked south. We've already checked north. It's one of these mysterious flying leopards yet again. A little chin spot battus alarm calling. They're often alarm call at anything, so you never know. Right next to that termite mound, which is always a good spot, especially for quarantine. He really loves a good termite mound. While I was walking, I could hear elephants all over this area, and you got to be very careful when you're walking or tracking in the bush when there are lots of elephants around. Almost wish it was really hot today, then he would probably wouldn't have moved at all, or very far, at least. There's nothing coming out on any of the roads. Just a bunch of tracks around that termite mound going in every which direction. Another question from Julia Smith about the Salu Game Reserve. And Julia would like to know, what are the differences between the Kruger and the Salu? Well, number one, the Salu is quite a lot bigger than even the Greater Transfrontier Park here. The Salu is about 5.4 million hectares, so 13 million acres. Maybe actually even more than that, sorry. And then that's not including the hunting concessions and stuff that surround it. So in total, you're probably looking at close to 6 or 7 million hectares. So 16 million acres in total. But that's the first difference. The other difference is, of course, the bush is very, very different. So probably 90% of the Salu is miombo woodland, Brachystegia woodland. So it doesn't have as high a carrying capacity as the Kruger. Now, it's got a lot more big river systems, the Rufiji, the Luwego, the Rovuma, the Kilombero, and those rivers are much bigger than any of the rivers in the Kruger. So around those rivers is where you have most of your game viewing, on the alluvial floodplains, and those areas are very, very productive. Also, you get some different species. So sable, for example, are quite common in the Salu. So are eland. You get a different type of wildebeest there called a Nyasa wildebeest. It's got a white chevron across its nose. And traditionally, or even today, most of the Salu south of the Rufiji River is designated hunting concessions. And of course, there's no hunting in the Kruger. Where, oh, where could you be, Mr. Quarantine? Hi, Arcadia. Katie is wondering, what is the difference between a regular reserve and a conservation reserve? I don't think there is a difference. Kruger is a regular reserve and it's used for conservation as well as tourism, and so is the Sabi Sands. I've never heard of a conservation reserve. They're sort of high conservation areas. Generally, when you refer to those areas, they normally have a very unique set of plant species or animal species that are endemic or endangered to that area. Sometimes, I think. So I'm trying to think. I can't really think of one offhand, but I think that I have heard that before. We'll check these elephant paths to the north here again. I wonder if the elephants didn't just keep chasing him. Of course, not the most wonderful tracking light, but I don't think at this speed I'm actually going to miss any tracks on any of the big elephant paths. If he happened to cross in one of the hard clay sections, that might be a different story. Becky Sleep would like to know, what animal that also occurs on Juma have I followed or watched for the longest amount of years? Juma, well, the Sabi Sands don't have any particularly different species, so I'd probably say all of them. I've followed and watched elephants, lion, leopard, wild dog, cheetah, impala, buffalo, for as long as I've been watching animals. I've been very lucky to live in areas that have all those animals. Now, I am flummoxed at the moment. I cannot figure out where this leopard has gone. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go down to the Mala Mala boundary and maybe go have a look if we can find the cheetah. And who knows, maybe when we come back, he'll just be sitting on top of the same termite mound. Quite often it happens with leopards, when you stop looking for them, they pop up. So we're going to try that tact. Just double checking some of those bigger trees there, making sure it hasn't popped an impala in a tree. It's chilly, chilly, chilly this evening. I think we're going to go have a quick look around the big open area to the south and come back again past this area. And then if we have no luck, I think we might start heading back for Juma, because it's a long, cold drive from down in Cheetah Plains. Aaron says, what is the wingspan of our flying leopard? Well, the first time I catch it flying, Aaron, I'll let you know. Let's go see if James is having a bit more luck than we are.
No. No more luck, everybody. Just the barren wilderness. I must say, it's very brave of Brent to have decided that, having given up on leopards, he's now going to look for cheetah. I wish him all the best with that one. Okay, what we're going to do, we've given up on the lions, we're going to head down towards the south and see if the queen hasn't come back across. And then we're going to head across to Arethusa and see if that Mvula sighting is still going. Because I think Rusty might be okay over there with some signal. So we'll just do a brief boat ride down to the south. See what we can see in the drainage here. Of course, this is where an animal might want to lie in the wind and cold. There is a buffalo kill on Biffle's Hook, by the way. And so were you visiting Vuyatela or Galago, you could be viewing there. Our signal doesn't cover that area at the moment. There's a lot. They killed the buffalo apparently sometime in the middle of this day, which is fantastic. But the torchwood pride, so not our ladies.
Joyce in New Hampshire, you make such a very good point. We constantly refer to these areas here as drainage lines, and yet you've never seen any water in them. Joyce, they do flow every so often if there's a really big flood. And they'll flow for a couple of hours and then they stop flowing again. But what happens is, I imagine that they were created, most of these old drainage lines like this were probably created probably thousands of years ago, you know. Before the advent of human settlement in the area, I think there would have been a lot more water flow. And I think there was probably a time when this was probably a much wetter area than it is now. So I think they would have flowed permanently back then. They would have cut these swathes down through here. But I don't think they were ever sort of permanent. The one tree that turns a lovely pink color during the winter, and that is the tamboti tree. Very toxic. Stopping to listen to see if I can hear terrified animals, alarm calling at the great plethora of predators we're sure to find around the next corner. No, nothing. That's very beautiful, Viam. I mean, for Viam to be filming a leaf by choice.
Desperate times.
Desperate times.
Like there's a dead one.
Now, B. Wilson, another very nice question on the subject of animal movements. And in an area like this, will animals move out of the area when all these leaves, because that beautiful orange or pinky leaf will eventually turn brown and yellow and then fall to the floor, as all dead leaves do. What will the animals do when all the leaves go? B. Wilson, they can't migrate. There's nowhere that... Well, I mean, they could, but there wouldn't be any real point because everywhere in the area is experiencing the same winter, the same drought. They used to migrate towards the mountains for the winter time, so they'd go off towards the wetter areas on the slopes of the Drakensberg Mountains. They can't do that anymore because of human settlement in the area, so that's simply not possible. But they will tough it out and they'll be okay, most of them. The only reason that this particular dry season or winter is going to be tougher than it would normally is because we had a very poor rainy season. And because of that very poor rainy season, I think some animals really are going to suffer during this winter time. And I know that in the Kruger already, there are hippopotamus pods that are having a desperately tough time. I think the buffalo will probably be okay. They will, I mean, by the time the rains come, if the rains come, sort of October time, November, they will be wearing it. They'll be tough. They will be, you know, they would have experienced a tough time. They'll be looking pretty thin and bony. But they should be able to cope. They've coped with it for many, many, many centuries. Although you wouldn't say so, would you, right now? You'd say that everything had probably absconded and migrated away as fast as possible, leaving the odd straggler, one or two dwarf mongoose, two duiker, one nyala, and one or two impala, who didn't get the memo about the mass migration out this morning. Ah, and apparently my list is more impressive than Brent's at the moment. I'm very sorry for Brent then. Now, Kathy, you say, are we expecting rain with these dark clouds? No. It was certainly not rain that would count. We'd have maybe a few spits. There were a few spits of rain this morning, but nothing that would sort of wet the ground even. No, so these fronts generally come through, and by the time they've hit us from the Cape, they've lost all their water. And so if you take a map of South Africa and you look at the southwestern Cape, at Cape Town, these fronts hit the Cape, they get very wet there, they are a winter rainfall area. As it moves up the Western Cape coast to the Eastern Cape, it may or may not rain, but by the time it gets up into the high veld or the highland areas of South Africa and then down into this area, it's all kind of rained out. They're all definitely summer rainfall areas and get very little rain during the winter, if any. I don't think we had any rain last year in winter at all. Rebecca, what was that? Click. Oh, there we go. Ooh, Kim, how many countries are there in Africa? I think there are 48 countries in Africa. 48?
I'm not going to try and list them all to you, but there are many, many. I think they're 48. South Africa, Zimbabwe, Zambia. No, I'm not going to try and list them all for you. We could try that. It's just, Rebecca will tell me how many there are. I'll see how many I can get to you. Countries. Okay, here we go, everybody. I'm going to try and name them for you because there are no animals to see. South Africa, obviously. Namibia, Botswana, Zambia, Mozambique, Zimbabwe. Angola, Democratic Republic of the Congo. Ethiopia, Somalia, Djibouti, Eritrea. Central African Republic. Congo, Brazzaville. Ghana, Gabon, Equatorial Guinea, I hope someone's counting this, Guinea-Bissau, Burkina Faso, Togo, Benin, Chad, of course those ones at the top there, Tunisia, Libya, Liberia, Morocco, Western Sahara, Mauritania, Mali. How many have I got so far, Rebecca? Kenya, Tanzania, Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, Egypt, of course, how could I forget Egypt? Algeria, Tunisia. I can tell there are going to be some obvious ones. The Gambia. Western Sahara, I think I said that one. I'm definitely, Nigeria. Yeah, that's about most of them, I think. So you can see there are lots and lots of them. Swaziland and Lesotho, yes, they are sort of part of South Africa, though, so they really count. There's some alarm calling birds in here, Vim. They've probably seen a very small snake, which will be invisible to us. You hear them shouting in there. Invisible shouting birds shouting at an invisible predator. Now, Roger, you're asking about poisonous or venomous snakes and constrictors. I'm going to answer that question while I stick my head over the top here, simply because these birds are alarm calling at something. So I'm going to do it very carefully. There are venomous snakes, remember, not poisonous. Venomous means that they can envenomate, they can bite you and make you sick, if you like. But poisonous means poisonous to eat. And there aren't many snakes that are poisonous to eat. Constrictors, yes. The python, the South African rock python. And some of the grass snakes are also constrictors. I'm just going to look up here at what these birds are alarming at. I'm now going to be silent. Don't see anything. I'll be with you now, everyone. Vim, can you still hear me?
A little bit.
They seem to be moving, these birds. No, I don't see anything, anyone. Maybe a little snake. Maybe they're just having a contretemps of their own. A little fight. An in-flock crossness. I'm coming back, Viam. Do you see me? With my busby attached to the front of my throat. Right, here we are. Exhausting. Ivory Coast. Another one. All of these very, very far away from us. Senegal. I nearly forgot Senegal. That's appalling. I remembered Egypt, yes.
Sudan, north and south. Right, we're now at the southern end of the reserve and we're going to head towards the west. No, Madagascar, Mauritius and Seychelles you cannot have, I'm afraid. They're just politically part of Africa, Rebecca. I'm not giving you those ones. All right, this is the end of our little drive down the river. Then we'll turn west towards Arethusa now. Sorry, Rob Reiner, I missed your question. The game drive radio is going on and off in my ear. Can you go again with that, Rebecca, please? Oh, do go-away birds tell other creatures to go away, or are they announcing that they're going away? They do actually alarm call like that. They go, quack, quack. If they see something that is terrifying, then they will make an alarm call, and they flock together and sit above it and shout and make a big noise. Give me 1 second here. That's a piece of grass that looks like a leopard head. Not even a piece of grass, it's a piece of bush. Not a leopard head at all, I'm afraid. Something like that, yes, Viam. Let's not embarrass ourselves any further. Let's see if we're very lucky and find Karula bringing her babies back onto Juma today. Oh, Viam, our luck, our cup runneth over. Three bird species in one place. Virtual starling flying off there. There we have a red-billed wood hoopoe, and also, astonishingly, Viam, a cape, not a hoop-hoop, no, a cape spurfowl. And you can see why it's called a spurfowl. Stand still, you beastly thing. There, you can see it on the back of its right leg. It's got a spur for fighting. Should have one on the left as well. This highlight of the day, yeah? See that spur? That's quite interesting. We don't often see it so obviously. I really thought they had one on each foot. I didn't know it was only on one, and that's for fighting. So much like chickens have got them, and certainly when they did cockfighting, terrible, terrible blight on human animal husbandry, I guess, they used a spur like that as well. Cape spurfowl is not called upon to fight for sport, though, thankfully. All right. Then a question about the pearl-spotted owlet, and are they still calling? Yes, they will be, but they don't call a huge amount. They don't call a huge amount now because we're going into the winter, or we're in the middle of the winter, and so they won't be being territorial and they won't be breeding right now. You won't believe it, everybody, but Brent Leo Smith, bless his cotton socks when he's wearing them, has found an elephant.
We've got two young bull elephants, the first thing we've seen in age, but they're not very relaxed. So we're keeping our distance a little bit from them. Hopefully they'll calm down, but this wind, elephants can often be quite skittish. So definitely not the leopard we were looking for, but beautiful creatures nonetheless. So two young boys in their 20s. I think they might be the only living soul on Cheetah Plains apart from those buffalo we saw earlier. Look at that. They're just, they've relaxed now nicely. We've stopped a little way away from them. We didn't try to go too close. And you can see their body language is nice and relaxed now. Probably, what do you say, 30 meters, 40 meters away. Oh, looks like you might go back and play in the mud. We're probably not going to see too much water splashing and mud spraying today. I don't think they need to cool down at all. Now what he's doing there is he's actually probably sniffing the urine of another elephant that was there earlier. Oh, he's proving me wrong. He's splashing mud on himself. It looked like he was about to. They are young boys. Young boys do silly things. Oh, is there going to be a bit of game? Well, James, it looks like James has found an elephant as well.
Well, this elephant, everybody, I don't mean to drag you away from Brent's, but this one was standing right on the top of that termite mound, trying to get at the lovely leaves of the Scotia brachypetella, or weeping boobean tree. He's looking at us with great suspicion in his eyes. But he was climbed right up there and at a sort of very awkward angle. He's just come down now. See if he goes up again. Elephants are surprisingly good climbers. Often when you're on foot and you see an elephant, you look around and you see a termite mound. Well, you see, think, well, you know, if he gets really upset, I'll just climb up the termite mound. And that would be a mistake because elephants can climb. Well, not quite like a leopard, but they can certainly get up and down a termite mound like that. Young bull. Very nice of him. That's very artistic.
Thank you.
Yes, excellent. Can we see the elephant again? Brilliant. That was actually a really lovely picture of his grey coat in the greyness of the bush and the clouds. There's a very ominous kind of atmosphere around here. Hasher, interestingly, oh, that's a beautiful look at his mouth as he chews there, that triangular-shaped bottom jaw. You want to know where the elephants go in the winter evenings? Oh, Tasha. Tasha, they go nowhere. They go where they are. They can't really go anywhere when it's cold because they live out here. And they don't get cold like us. You can see they've got absolutely no hair on their bodies other than that sort of beard he's got underneath his chin. And a little bit of hair on the head. That's a remarkable shot. And, of course, the hair that they have on their tails. And there's a really sort of interesting physiological discussion around that. And it basically goes that the larger you are, the slower you will be to heat up, but the slower you will be to cool down. So if you're a rodent like a bushveld gerbil, then you're going to have to watch out for the cold. You're going to have a burrow to live in, and you're going to have thick fur. You're going to have to eat fatty foods that can help maintain a very fast metabolic rate. If you're an elephant, sorry, I'm just going to wait for that to go past. There we go. And Tasha, if you're an elephant, well, you just don't lose heat that quickly, which means that you're not going to be that cold. So you probably just try and get out of the wind. You probably go into some thick bush, maybe in a drainage line, to just get out the wind. But otherwise, you won't really feel it that much. Doesn't have very good table manners, does he? It's with his mouth open. That's wonderful to see. I must say, I think we're quite lucky here. Donna, a very good point from you. You say we often see white bits in the elephant's eyes. You want to know if it's ticks. No, it's not. It's like sleep. You know when you wake up and you've got sort of grime on the inside of your eyes? That's just what that is. And I think in the dusty winter, their eyes do water quite a lot. And I think in the dusty winter time, that's wonderful. In the dusty winter, those tears get sort of almost form mud with all the dust that there is around, and they just get stuck there. And you said, do they remove them with their trunks? Most certainly. They scratch their eyes with their trunks a lot. They scratch their ears too. It's obviously not bugging him too much, though. He's having a lovely meal. And he'd love to be eating grass, he really would, but just no green grass left for him. Now, interestingly, an elephant, a fully grown elephant bull, has got a greater reach into a tree than a giraffe does. Which I think is quite fascinating, given how tall a giraffe is. Here he comes. Seems to be walking straight towards us, that's quite nice. Well, it will be nice if he doesn't come all the way to us. He's a youngish bull. And what he's doing, everyone, is just, I remain convinced that elephants are highly intelligent, and I think they get bored. I think they get bored out of their minds by walking around, eating all day long. And now here is a bit of entertainment, a bit of company for them to engage with. Don't push that tree over, I shall be very cross with you. Not that you care, but I will be. And I think he's having a scratch, but he's also saying to us, hi, what's happening in your life? I'm a bit bored. Isn't that nice? Amy, lovely question from you. You say, do elephants have toes and do they use them? They do have toes. Well, they've got toenails, certainly. And do they use them? Well, they don't use them for balance like we do. They do use their toes to a certain extent, though. Or their toenails they've got. They don't use their toenails, though. I mean, they don't really have anything to use them for. When they tend to fall out. But, Amy, what's interesting, if you look at the inside of an elephant's foot, it's got all the same bones that your hands and feet do. So they definitely have fingers and toes in just about the same way that we do. Yes, that is correct. That is what I said. Now, Betty, I'm going to talk a little bit more quietly as this fellow comes up to say hello to us. You say, why does an elephant, let me get out of the way, move its front foot from side to side when it's standing and watching us? Betty, that's an extremely observant question. And the reason they do it is the same reason that you do it when you go into a social situation where you're not comfortable, where you're feeling a little bit awkward. He's definitely interacting with us, you know. Hello, fella. He's probably about 20, so he's not quite confident yet. If he was a big 45-year-old bull wandering up to us at that speed, I would probably have moved away. So, Betty, it's just the same. It's called displacement behavior. He's just kind of, he's just sort of fiddling. Like, you know, if you've got something in your pocket that you fiddle with, he's now only about 2 meters, 2.5 meters from us. You've got like your lipstick in your pocket, or perhaps you've got a phone in your pocket and you just twiddle it around or fiddle with your collar cuff or your skirt hem. In an awkward social situation, that's exactly what that is. What a spectacular sighting of a very confiding young bull elephant And I truly believe that he is as grateful for our company as we are for his. Even if it's not particularly conscious gratefulness. That's wonderful. So he didn't have to come down here. Oh, okay, sure. Paul, you want me to stand behind next to that tree for a size comparison? The elephant has now moved off. I'll go and do that. VM, I won't move the car. I'll go as quickly as I can. You can't even see me. This is where he was standing originally. Oh, good. What, through my mic? Oh, okay, so I can talk like this. I don't need to yell at you. Perfect. So, he was standing where I'm standing now, originally. And, I mean, it is really steep here. Of course, his backside was up against the tree here. And then he walked down to here and knew, I'm going to disappear from view. He sort of slid down here, like that. And when he was feeding, he's standing where I am now. You can't even see me. So, that elephant will get at least a third bigger than he was. Than he is, sorry. And he probably stands about, I don't know, say 8 feet at the shoulder at the moment. He might get up to about 11 feet when he's fully grown. I'm astounded you can still hear me. Shame, I must have blasted your ears there. What do you think that came out of? I can't think what that is. Do you know? That's really odd, I wonder. No, it's too big. It's a bit big. I don't know what that is. I'd love to know if anybody... Oh, you know, it's probably an owl. Possibly an owl. Very nice. Just very red. On we go. I smell rain, Liam. You know, it's just, it would be precisely my luck that when I said that it was highly unlikely we'll get any rain, or certainly nothing that's going to be meaningful, the first winter deluge in the 10 millennia arrives today. That was a wonderful, wonderful sighting. What a treat. On we go. Right, like I said, we're going to go around here and see if we can't pick up some tracks of Karula the Queen. And if we don't pick those up, we'll just pop on to Arethusa and get an update there. You smell the rain, Vim?
Yes.
No, she's talking. What? It's raining on Cheetah Plains, on poor old BLS. Oh, let me just fix the comms again. I shall have to write a technical report for Connor. No, lost. Oh, I haven't got my earpiece in. It's not a problem with the comms. There we go. Now you can talk to me. What an idiot I am. Hello, Kathleen. You're in Kansas, and you want to know why it is that the wind would make an animal the size of an elephant uneasy. Elephants have a very strange, or seemingly strange, response to predators. They are, I think, unnaturally terrified of predators. We've seen them react extremely defensively to wild dogs, certainly to leopards and lions. They react very defensively. Hyenas too, probably. Oh, spitting on us now. And Kathleen, the reason I'm going through all of that detail is that the wind response is a response to their fear of predators. It's the same as every other animal out here. When it starts to blow, it's difficult to hear what's coming, it's difficult to smell what's coming, and it becomes, in light like this, difficult to see what's coming too. And so all animals are uneasy in the wind. They're cold as well. And I think what you'll find with elephants is that that seemingly overzealous response to any kind of predator is exacerbated, is increased by the wind. It's the same reason that you find it eerie when the wind is blowing. It's the same, exactly the same. When you go outside on a stormy night, it's a you get a sense of intimidation. You get a sense of, I get nervous, well, not nervous, but you certainly feel that sense of, I don't know, eeriness. And that, I think, is a sort of throwback to our evolutionary past. You know, if you go outside now and it's dark and blustery into your garden, the chances of you being set upon by some sort of predator are very slim to zero. But we still feel that. We still feel like if a criminal is going to attack, it's going to be on a blustery, cold night. And that's a throwback to our evolutionary past, when that's when predators were very difficult to perceive, difficult to hear, difficult to smell on windy nights and windy days. Now, this is where I had the little cubbies yesterday. They've moved now. But Viam and I will just relive the memory of seeing George in that tree there that you can see. Good old Georgie boy. And his sister Charlotte on the termite mound. Just the other side. I don't see her there now, Viam. Do you see her? Oh, Charlotte. It's okay. I'll get over it. I think she's taken them south into Little Gowrie, which is the reserve, excuse me, to the south of us. Did I knock the aerial down again? Viam, you must sort that out, otherwise your life's going to be very difficult. The aerial keeps falling over, everyone. That's the antenna. There's definitely a bit of spitting of moisture coming out of the air. And it's unusually dark for this time of the day, I feel. It is very dark. I might have to turn some lights on already. What is that? It's the White Crown Shrike. There's some kudu, Viam. That's number 7, I think. Good grief, our cup doth run over. Oh, by the way, everybody, Viam pointed out to me that I called a red-billed hornbill a red-billed woodhoopoo just now. I was talking an utter load of nonsense. That bird with a red beak pecking about on the ground was a red-billed hornbill, not a red-billed hoopoo. So I do apologise for that. Viam, of course, will never let me forget it. Too late. I had to change my hat, you see, it's getting a little cold, and I don't like to do it publicly because what happens is that this part of my head, especially with the light shining on it, will blind you. Unlike my good friend Steph, who has managed to completely accept and embrace his lack of hair, I have not yet. Now, what's wrong with my Busby? It sounds muffled. It's in the same place. Does it still sound muffled? There we go. I think it's your earphones or your ears. No, let's not go this way. Let's go the other way. We're now at Treehouse Dam, where no thirsty animals have come to drink, because it's just not hot enough to be thirsty. JJ Kerry, a nice question from you about being on foot with hyenas. JJ, that you say, would we be safe being on foot with them? JJ, Viam and I actually found that den on foot. And when we got there, how many were there? Three or four hyenas there when we found it eventually. And they all just ran away. So yes, you'd be relatively safe. I think that if you were to walk up to it, that mother would run away. If you then decided to stick your head down into the den site, she might be encouraged to come back. She wouldn't for most other predators, but I think hyenas are clever, and if they sense any kind of weakness, so if you were on the ground perhaps and you bent over and you tried to sort of fish her babies out of the den site, then I think she'd become very upset. But mostly, if you walk up to a hyena den site, the adults disappear, the babies go down into the den where they're safe, and that's what they do. Hyenas normally on foot, completely fine to view, normally run away. I had one experience on this reserve, and that was, I mean, that was about a year ago, actually. I was walking around where, just near Biffelzoek Dam, looking for something, and I saw a hyena. And instead of running away, she stopped and she looked at me like that. So I clapped my hands and she ran. And then I came around a bush and she was waiting there for me. So I made a big noise and sort of chased her. Because, you see, once a predator out here realizes that we are completely pathetic physical specimens, well, then the game's up. I mean, it's a completely psychological hold we have over the animals out here. The reason we can drive around like this, we can walk around relatively safely, is that animals see us as the apex predator, which we are if we're armed and if we're in a big group. On our own, however, we're massively vulnerable. But the animals don't know that. And that's why when you hear about man-eating lions and man-eating tigers and leopards, and people in the media especially, or in stories and legends, like to say, well, once a lion gets a taste for human blood, well, it'll never go back again. It's not a taste for human blood at all. All it is the fact that they realize that we're really easy to kill, much more so than something like a baboon or an impala. We're slower, we don't have very big teeth, and we're not very strong. So that's all that is. At night, it's a different story. They will generally be a lot more confident. So you don't want to be knocking about at night on foot. And Rob Beach, I don't think I've heard from you before, so if it is your first question, thank you for asking it. You want to know if any of us have been bitten by a big cat before, any of the presenters? No, I don't think any of us have been bitten by a big cat. I haven't, certainly. Steph hasn't been bitten by a big cat. Brent, I don't think so. Pretty sure he hasn't. No, Jamie hasn't been bitten by a big cat. You don't generally, you're not often able to tell the story if you get bitten by a big cat.
I got bitten once by a pretty big cat.
Oh, I see, you mean a big house cat. Yes. Viam's been bitten by a big house cat, everybody. Was it your own cat, Viam?
Yes.
Oh. Why did it bite you?
They do that.
They do that, okay. Viam's cat, everyone, while we're not looking at much, adopted him. Not the other way around. It arrived in his house one day and remained. That's correct, isn't it, Viam?
Yes.
And then when he moved to Cape Town, it went with him. In the car, not in a basket. And it has never left.
Yeah, the basket I bought was a bit too small.
The basket was too small. It was a big cat, is it? There's another kudu. Grief. And impala, mixed species, and a fork-tailed drongo. I don't know where to look. HK, you want to know if it's dangerous for me to drive around in an open vehicle like this in a wilderness area? HK, this is a common question, and it's a good one. And the answer is, the flippant answer will be, well, I don't have a death wish, so yes, it is completely safe. The more full and respectful answer would be, yes, it is, because the animals don't see us, or the predators, the potentially dangerous animals, don't see us as a threat in here. They don't see us, our upright posture, and so they tend to perceive the vehicle as something of an outline on its own, without us in it, if you know what I mean. Do I believe that animals don't know what we are in here? No, I don't believe that, because like a friend of mine once said, a leopard can spot a monkey's ear sort of sticking out from behind a tree. So they must know what we are, but they just don't perceive us in the same way. There are some cats, not in this area. I mean, I know in parts of India, if you're viewing some of the tigers, then they'll put a cage around the car because there seems to be a risk. But I don't think that that's the case. So thank you very much for that, AK. We're perfectly safe in the cars here. And if you would ever come out here and come on Game Drive, you would feel completely safe. Let's go across to Brent. He's got a primate.
Well, there's a vervet monkey who's looking about as unhappy with life as I am at the moment. Well, that one's keeping watch while the others are actually quite spread out. You can't really see them up in the tree there. But there are some on the ground, and there's a sentinel. Oh, I've just got to talk to James. So you're going to get the same update I want to give James. James, just to let you know, they've got Karula and my pimpin somewhere at Hoffman's boundary, little gari. And quite far south of the boundary, somewhere on the boundary between the next southern property. Or maybe it's called something else. So, there we go. You heard Karula and her cubs are to the south of the boundary. Hello, monkeys! He's a shivering monkey, like me. Now, somehow, I have managed to misplace one glove each. So, I've misplaced the right-hand glove like this, and I've misplaced the left-hand mitten. So, now we are rolling with two different gloves today. So, what I think we're going to do is we're going to leave these monkeys. I think they're probably going to rest up here. They don't look like they want to move too much. And we're going to head towards the northern boundary, and I want to scour for any possibility of those inkahumas. If they didn't catch anything big last night, there's a good chance they're going to start moving in this cold, windy weather. Well, we should actually be maybe a little happy. Karula is keeping her cubs to the south. Vula, I'm sure, has finished that warthog and could pop up anywhere. And then Sindile being around is also quite dangerous. Now, Dave and I rushed from Cheetah Plains back to Juma. And if you had seen us 5 minutes ago, you wouldn't have been able to see me very well. Firstly, because there was all the water on the lens, it was raining down there, but also I decided to make a new, I tied my scarf around my head because it was so cold, like that. See, now, this is actually what a cameraman normally looks like. So normally when I turn around to talk to you guys in the camera, behind the camera there's some creature like this, and quite often, sunglasses on as well, so I literally cannot see any skin. So, but fortunately, Dave made a very schoolboy error today, and I even told him, but he's trying to be tough, and it's tough being tough, because I'm not giving him my blanket, and he's wearing shorts.
Oh, it's alright, it's not too cold.
It's not too cold. Should we drive faster? Yes. I even said to Dave at the beginning of the drive, you sure you don't want to wear long pants? You sure you don't want to take an extra blanket? No, I'm fine, I'm tough, you know. Yeah, I'm tough being tough. Oof, but the positive note is you never know, a cat might start moving and might be hunting in this cold, windy weather. This is ideal cat hunting weather. It's actually only one way for it to get much better, and that's for it to get dark. There'll still be enough ambient light bouncing off the moon, I mean not the moon, the clouds, that the cats will be able to see enough to hunt tonight. And that warm weather obviously caught me because I'm missing one of each glove and I'm missing my warm hat. I must definitely dig it out. Hi, Tasha. Tasha would like to know if the animals can, or if we can smell the rain, so can the animals also, and does it make them go into hiding? Tasha, well, I think it's the wind that'll put the animals into hiding rather than the rain, and I'm sure they can smell it. When I say rain, it was a slightly above strong drizzle is probably a better description, but in case there was heavier rain, Dave and I did not want to be caught all the way on Cheetah Plains. It's quite a long drive, it's about 20 minutes. And 20 minutes in the pouring rain at this temperature, even Dave might stop being tough. No sign of anything along a Cheetah cut line today. It's almost time to put my lights on. Now, not so I can see where I'm going, but to see if there are any tracks on the road. I think the best way to describe it at the moment is bitterly cold. But often, this weather, I've had some of my best big cat sightings. If you've got a big cat and you can follow them hunting in this weather, it's really, really good, and they have a much better chance of catching something. And of course, if you're not out on drive, you're not going to see anything at all. Now, I heard James was naming the countries in Africa, so I've got a quiz for you guys. And I'd like to know, what's the smallest country in Africa? I can tell you now, Dave didn't know. Right, what is the smallest country in Africa? If you know what the smallest country in Africa is, and don't cheat, don't use Google, let me know, and you can do that by using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. What is the smallest country in Africa? Well, since I think we're not going to see too many animals unless we find some cats, I think I'm going to dedicate the rest of the sunset safari to a few quizzes. Because we're not going to be seeing a sunset either. And we should call it a darkening safari. Very thankful to have one of each. And if I had two of the same, then I would be very, very grumpy with life. Ooh, the rain's getting a bit, well, the drizzle's getting a bit more drizzly again. Well, we're not quite ready to reach for rain covers. It is threatening, but I'm hoping it's going to hold off. I think the very British way of putting what we're experiencing at the moment, it is spitting. Yes, we are being spat upon by the heavens. Now, for those of you not sure, I'll be going on leave after tomorrow's sunrise safari, and I'll be meeting up with Jamie, and we're off to a friend's wedding on the south coast of KwaZulu-Natal, and we're looking forward to being by the seaside. and it'll be quite fun. So you will have Steph James and one of our new freelance guides. He tried out a while ago, and I'm sure some of you remember him. His name was Byron. I think he tried out just before Jamie started. So he'll be coming for a couple of days while myself and Jamie are away. So from a cold, windy part of Juma Private Game Reserve that has not a living soul apart from dangerous and tough Dave Eastall and myself, let's go across to Viam and James, who have apparently the exact same thing we do.
We're on Arethusa, everybody, and we are heading in a northerly direction, which is only relevant because I can't show you any animals. Update on Karula. Brent gave you, of course, she's south of the reserve, but we did come into the area where Mvula was. He apparently crossed east onto, or his tracks crossed east onto Vuyatela or onto Juma sometime this morning. So we're going to head back that way and see if we can't pick him up somewhere around Impala Plains or Sydney's Dam, maybe lurking in the shade of a gwarri bush where he'll be a little bit sheltered from the rain, which is starting to spit upon us, is it not, Viam? Not so much anymore. I've closed up all of my camera equipment so that I can't take any really awful photographs and light like this. You always know you're on Arethusa when you hit those bumps, which are drainage humps, also designed to test the suspension of the best kind of 4x4. So what we're going to do is drive all the way up to the gate, to the Sabisan gate, and then we're going to turn down and come down our main access road and see if we don't pick something up there. And also maybe those jackals. There have been some silverbacked / side-striped jackals lurking about on Impala Plains. Now we've got to be very careful turning onto the main road here, because people do drive with rather hurried speed along here. Okay, this is the boundary now between Arethusa to our left and Juma to our right, and Mvula just up to the north of us there, headed to the east, so that's on to Juma. So we're going to drive a little bit faster, and we'll see if we aren't very lucky. Right back there, Viam, you cold? It is getting a little bit chillsome out here. There, everybody, is a magpie gone. No, gone, never mind. No magpie shrikes for me. 7 mammal species. Come on, let's get it up to 26. You know that there are 135 mammal species in the Kruger National Park? I've got no chance to name them all. And not, as Rebecca rather sardonically says in my right ear, not one of them is near us. That's not true, Rebecca. I guarantee you we're driving past many rodents lurking underneath the ground, very close to where we are now. I guarantee you also that we're driving past bats roosting and possibly taking to the wing. Certainly nothing large enough to see without the aid of a scanning electron microscope possible. Oh, my leggies are getting cold. Viam, I'm going to have to put a blankie on my leggies. There we go. Oh, that's much better now.
Aqua, a wonderful question from you, and I'm so glad you asked it, because the other day we had precisely what you just asked. You say, is it possible to ever see roosting or foraging fruit bats? Not often, but yes, we saw one the other day. We saw Wahlberg's epileptic fruit bat. You know where we stopped for that tamburti tree earlier on with the beautiful sort of pinky orange peachy leaves? That tree had a fruit bat in it, and it flew out as soon as it saw us and sort of flew off. But it was a big fruit bat, about that big. So yes, it is possible. It's the only one I've ever seen here, and I think I've only ever seen one other. I think let's go up this road, actually. Let's not go all the way to the gate on this road. We'll go down here. So Mvula was heading that way. Maybe he's in these thickets. There's some big thickets up here. And I wonder why he's finished his warthog already. He's either finished it or something has lifted it from him. I saw another mammal on the road here, everyone. I think it was a dicas. It doesn't really count. We've seen one of him already. But the other kinds of bats, I think they're probably probably up to 15 or 20 species of bats in this area. We've got 9 antelope species, 3 cats, 3 big cats, 3 small cats. I still can't get anywhere near 135 though. Of course, every rodent we see, we pass off as a bush-filled gerbil, and there may well not be. Right, now this is the kind of area where he might be lurking about the place. Just starting to get moving as the night begins to fall. Did you see him there, Vim? No. What a disappointment. At least we had an elephant. And a diker. Let me get my spotlight out. Try not to write off Rusty while I do it. Right, Vim, I'm now going to spot everything. Or not. Ah, Vim has also got a light. That's excellent news. Good. Good idea, Vim. Now we're going north again. And going north at this time of the night is a very good idea when the wind is blowing from the south, because it means it isn't freezing your face. We'll just stop up here and have a little bit of a listen and see what we can hear, other than arrow-marked babblers calling. Maybe there will be an impala shouting at a Mvula who's just woken up. All right, so let's have a proper listen. Actually, quite a lot of nice sound out here. Brent has got a turkey to show you.
The ones that are fighting. They've got something there. There's 3 or 4 of them that were fighting over it looked like maybe a lizard or a snake even. I can't see now, but we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 ground hornbills. Isn't this incredible? Lovely big flock of one of the most endangered birds. Go a little bit to the left there. There's some... There. What are they? Oh, pecking into a piece of wood, seeing if there was anything in it. Isn't that incredible? See, the one at the back there, that's a male. So I'm telling that by the large casque. Now, a casque is that extended piece of the beak that's on top. And unfortunately, we are in a bit of a gremlin zone. I'm going to try roll to keep with them, but we might lose you. Off they go to roost. They'll probably sleep in those dead trees tonight. So we should be treated to a dawn chorus of doo, 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 doo. There's still one on the ground, or two, actually. There we go, that's the male. Oh, beautiful camera, David. How exquisite. Aren't they just magnificent creatures? And as James says, they're about turkey-sized. Now, very different feeding from a turkey. They're actually incredible predators. And I don't want to disturb them. I want them to stay there for the night, so I'm going to move away from them. We'll keep talking about them. Now, actually, in the Venda culture, they're considered to be the king of the birds. And the folklore goes that there was a war between the snakes and the birds, and the king of the snakes, the black mamba, was winning the battle and massacring the birds. Oh, but I'll finish that story shortly. Apparently we've got a few gremlins. We'll be back a little later.
Sorry about that, everybody. Those turkeys, of course, probably the highlight of our drive so far, other than that wonderful elephant. We're just looking around here for the side-striped jackals. I was just saying before you left us, there's quite a lot of bird song. It's largely drongos. The odd white-browed scrub robin. And there are also some pearl-spotted owls going. They're being imitated by drongos. A definite smell of petrichor, you know. So somewhere it's been raining. And I think actually one of the game drives from Vuyatela has shut down because they were rained on. No silver-backed foxes here, Liam. See if Mavula is around the corner, sitting regally on a termite mound or draped luxuriantly in a tree. Now, in this tree up ahead here, this very big one, there was a bush baby nest. This is round about the time they'll start coming out, maybe a little bit early, especially given the weather. But let's just have a look-see. A little bit off the road here. Now, up in the top there, I've only ever seen them in here once. It was in that hole there where the light is shining and where there are no bush babies. See that, Liam? No bush babies at all. Bush baby free tree. Oh, how sad. On we go. Ooh. Apparently Rebecca got a fright there. Rebecca, don't get a fright. Everything is all right. Everything is okay. Other than the lack of animals, everything is absolutely fine. Well, the elephants have been around here, pushing trees over. Darlene in New Hampshire, you're saving me. Thank you very much. You've asked me for a short Shangaan lesson. That I can do for you, especially while we're driving along. You say, just a couple of greetings. Well, good morning is Avsheni, Avsheni, or Avusheni.
That means good morning. And then if you said to somebody, Avusheni, you would respond, Aye, which I love. It's just such a kind of, yes, hello, I see you. Aye. So you say, Avshen, Aye. Then you would ask how someone was, and you'd say, Unjani. And the U means you. Njani means how. So Unjani, how are you? Unjani, and if you were saying, I'm fine. In most of the South African languages, you have to say you're fine. Even if you've just been run over by a bus, you must, or buffalo, you must say, I'm fine, but a buffalo has just gored me. So you'd say, Ndiko, I'm fine. Maranyari indipile. I'm fine, but a buffalo has just hit me. So you must always say you're fine. So you'd say, Ndiko, or Ndipfukile. Ndipfukile means I'm fine. Dipfukile, it actually means I'm still alive, well, I'm awake. Which you would think was a given, given that you were speaking to somebody. So, we'll go through that once more. Darlene, you will give the responses. I will give the initial greeting. So I will say to you, Darlene, Avshen, to which you will reply, Ahe. To which I shall reply, Unjani, how are you? And you will say, Dipfukile. I am fine, I am awake. There we go. Then in the middle of the day, you would say, excuse me, there's a diker. In the middle of the day, you would say, Nhlegani, which basically means good midday. Nhlegani, instead of Avusheni, and the sound is made by pushing your tongue onto the top of your mouth, and then blowing. And if you're Welsh, you'll have no trouble saying that. It's a very Welsh sound. Nhlegani. And then in the afternoon or in the evening, you would say Riperile. Riperile, which means good evening or good afternoon. It's kind of late afternoon. Riperile. There we go. Absolutely nothing at Sydney's Dam. There we go. And James Dungan, nice question from you. You say, does Shangaan have any of those clicking sounds? No, it doesn't. It's a whistling language. It has words like sesi and tsutsuma and zani. And so all of those have got little whistles in the front of them. I'm not going to go through what they all mean. But the languages in South Africa that have clicks are the Nguni languages, like isiXhosa. IsiXhosa and Zulu. They all have clicks in them. And there's that wonderful phrase that goes, iqaqa lidlula umgwaqo. Iqaqa lidlula umgwaqo. Which basically means, I think, the frog crosses the road. Iqaqa lidlula umgwaqo. There you go. But Shangaan, no clickety clicks, just many whistly whistles. I see the lights of a spaceship up ahead. Do you see them, Viem? Do you see that spaceship? I think that might be BLS, a.k.a. the Big Loud Sound, a.k.a. Brent Leo Smith. Let us go and commiserate on the lack of animals with him. I must say, it is quite an impressive sight, seeing all those lights coming towards you. We've got to turn them all off now, or we'll blind him. Hello!
You're coming down the right road.
Yes, I know.
Oh,
yes, we must shake hands, of course, just to show that we still like each other.
This is
a profound number of animals today, wouldn't you say?
Yes,
lots and lots of them. Really, it's been difficult to know what to look at, I find. We've seen seven mammal species, all of which have run away at high speed.
I just started doing some quizzes.
I see.
And do you know what the current quiz is?
Dung. That's the desperation quiz.
What is the smallest, because you were naming African countries and decided to go, what is the smallest country
in Africa? Could you explain to me what has happened to your one fishing glove?
I've lost one of each.
So one fishing glove is gone and one thermolate mitten also. At least you do. That is.
I think we're both thinking the same thing, that young Cinderella might pop out at some point.
It would be very nice if something popped out. I'd be very happy with any leopard, lion, mongoose at this stage. No. Buffalo up ahead.
Yes, they're
funny. Oh, are they?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm in the Orbeez.
Good luck.
Bye.
Vive la France. Those buffalo are running. I wonder if they're not running from lions. Let me just call Brent quickly. Brent, come in.
Anyway.
Brenty, they were running, charging across the cut line here. I don't know if you want to check the fire break area.
Copy, Wolfie.
Maybe the lions are here. So they were running across where we are now. We'll just go down, I think we'll go down this road here. This is where they were running.
Okay.
There might be a lion here.
Okay, what? Where are you now? All reasons of the fire break and a small family of the area running at high speed out of Boston Soccer. Okay, there is an update of Gorilla Crossing, already close to Gary, Vietella, by close to, west of the cut line, where I understand.
It's interesting.
So I just put them when they were updating it, but yeah, it was always in the north channel.
B. Wilson, nice one from you. You want to know if there's a common language to Africa, if there's a kind of language that, a fallback language. There isn't. There are regional fallback languages. So in this particular area, if you spoke Zulu, for example, you could make yourself understood to Ndebeles and Xhosas and Swazis and some Ndebeles in Zimbabwe, for example. But then you'd be lost the further north you went. So, and then in East Africa, it's Swahili. If you can speak Swahili, you can get around with Tanzania, Kenya, and all those areas. But you know, B, in Nigeria alone, there are over 150 mutually unintelligible languages. So no, there's no fallback African language. Let's go back across to Brent. He's not far from where we are here.
I just saw you with James. Yes, but I'm going to take this chance to finish off that story about ground hornbills. So they're saying in Venda culture, they're considered to be the king of the birds. So history goes, the birds and the snakes were having an immense battle, but the snakes were winning. Because the king of the snakes, the black mamba, was just so effective at biting all the birds, and eventually the birds went and begged the ground hornbill, who'd remained like Switzerland up to this point neutral, and eventually the ground hornbill agreed to take up the birds' strife. And what happened was that met out in the battle, and the black mamba slithered up to the front mocking the birds. Is this the best you've got? I have dispatched all your warriors. And the ground hornbill promptly bit him in half. And that was the end of the king of the snakes. And then the birds made the reluctant ground hornbill a very reluctant king of the birds. They, of course, really, really adept at eating snakes. That's probably where the origins of that folklore come from. Now, of course, we had a little quiz going a bit earlier, and I was being a bit naughty because there are, I suppose we can say, two correct answers. And because, of course, Africa also includes the surrounding islands. So Whitney, JJ, and Kerry all said the Gambia, which is correct. That is the smallest country in the landlocked Africa. But the smallest country in Africa in terms of it can be part of the African Union and all that is the group of islands that are called the Seychelles. And they are less than 170 miles squared. It's tiny, tiny, tiny. And of course that was Laura who got that right, the Seychelles. But I didn't specify, so I have to admit that you could have answered with both. Now, since we've already done the smallest country in Africa, what's the largest? Dave?
DRC?
DRC, are you sure?
I'm pretty sure.
Oh, Dave. Dave says the Democratic Republic of Congo. Do you agree with Dave or not? Let me know. Hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Or send me an email, questions@wildearth.tv. Well, it used to be the Sudan, but they've cut that in two now. But is Dave right with the DRC? What have we got there? I think Lee Pad, your answers, your what? Sorry, your wish has been answered. But hopefully it hangs around. Lee Pad wanted to see some bush babies, and I just saw an eye in the tree around here. But sometimes in this foul weather, they don't hang around too long, and it doesn't look like that one did. Unfortunately, but I will keep checking. Now, Lee Pad would like to know what are the differences between the two species. Well, they're very easy to tell apart. The one we see on drive is about this big. It literally would fit into my hand. And the thick-tailed is about the size of a domestic cat. So very difficult to get them confused. The thick-tailed generally live along the bigger rivers where there's a lot more sort of fruiting trees like fig trees and things like that. The lesser bush baby or the South African bush baby, which we see, occurs throughout, even along the rivers but also up in the drier areas. It's not the greatest bush baby weather. They're not too fond of the cold either, so they might be snuggled up a little bit longer than they normally are on an evening like tonight. Now, I'm convinced the Nkuma ladies are somewhere in here to the left. Now, it's that area where there's lots of river systems and very steep dongas, which is a drainage line type thing. And unfortunately, we can't even get a vehicle in there, or if we do, it's quite difficult. Hopefully, they'll come out for tomorrow's sunrise safari. Now, the one thing that might be out tonight a little bit earlier are those gorgeous white-tailed mongoose on quarantine. Maybe an African civet in this cold weather, or even a serval. We're heading up towards a good bush baby spot now. Civet, African civet. Right in the road. I'm not going to try to get too close just yet. Look at that. I just said we might see a civet. There's one. It looks quite relaxed, and I said this colder weather might bring them out. We're gonna try inch a bit closer. Isn't that exciting? We don't get to see them too often. See him there, Dave? Well, he's walking quite slowly away from us. Let me just see if we can get another angle. He stopped to look at us in the center of the light. Dave, you got a gap through there? He's right at the back of the light there. I'm just going to move forward again a little bit. There might be a way to see him through the bushes. Have moved off, but he didn't look too unrelaxed. So what I'm going to do is, he is heading that way there. I'm going to go around and up onto the power lines, and we might get lucky enough to get another glimpse of him. So there's an open patch on the other side of that thicket. Sorry, Dave, I nearly lost him. I just wanted to saw something else there. Oh, it's a sleeping buffalo. Oh, there's a little grey diker. Okay. Where are you, Mr. Civet? So we saw him coming up towards the power lines here. So he's going to be on our right here somewhere. Look at him run. Hi, Arbeard. I'm going to try and get one last glimpse. Arbeard's wondering, is a civet a cat? It is not at all. It's probably far more closely related to mongoose. But if you had to, even though they're not related at all, it's similar sized and looks a little bit like a raccoon. There he is. Now, this is the African civet. You do get tree civets in Asia and a palm civet further north in Africa. But this is the biggest one, or biggest civet species. Let's see if we keep parallel. He seems quite relaxed. Disappearing, he's about to come out into the open here. You got him, Dave? There he is. Now, Arcadia says civets are responsible for the most expensive coffee in the world. Now, that is coffee that is beans that have passed through the digestive system of the Asiatic palm civet. No, we don't do it here, which was Arcadia's next question. Those are Asiatic palm civets or Asiatic tree civets. We don't have any tree or palm civets here. We've only got these guys. Now, they are omnivores. They hunt all sorts of little things, rodents, mice, other stuff like that. Oh, isn't that coat just exquisite? Try to go back a little bit. Stay there, Dave, stay there. Oh dear. Maybe we'll get one last glimpse again. Let's just try. But he is going into a thick area. Oh, we're not gonna. I think that's it, I'm afraid. Oh, there. But I think I can just see the eyes through the thicket now. Right at the back there. He's moving that way from right to left. Can just make out the eye to the left-hand side. Oh, dear. But wasn't that fantastic? That's definitely not something we get to see all the time. And as I said, this colder weather is why we saw that civet this early in the evening. And James Richard's wondering, are civets territorial? Now, they are very much so. Oh, sorry, Dave. And they have middens where they scent mark, and those are called civetries. Now, civet, as a mammal species goes, are quite interesting. Now, millipedes or songololos, you've seen us all show you them and pick them up. Now, they eat a lot of detritus. They also eat some poisonous plants. And one of those poisonous plants is a wolfaria. And what happens is that's got hydrogen cyanide in it. So a lot of the butterfly caterpillars and millipedes will eat this plant, and it makes them quite noxious to eat. Now, civets and certain dica species in the rainforest are the only mammals that are able to eat millipedes. And the reason for this is that their pancreas creates a very specialized amylase, which breaks down those cyanide proteins into a non-harmful to the animals. So civets out here, quite a few bird species can eat them, but civets, the only mammal species we get here that can eat millipedes and eat lots of millipedes and survive. So quite often when you see a civetry, one of the telltale signs is the fact that it's lots of millipede exoskeletons. Now, it doesn't often work like that. Oh, we might see a white-tailed mongoose or a civet, and not even 5 seconds later, there was a civet on the road in front of us. I see one around my house quite often here later in the night, but it's because of this cold weather that it's out mobile a bit earlier than it would normally be. Normally, they're only going to be coming out sort of 8:30, 9 o'clock at night after the peak predator times. But when you have cold weather like this, there is a chance that some of those animals come out a bit earlier. This is always a good area for bush babies. And as I said, I think tonight's a bit chilly for the bush babies. There's also a dead tree I like to check for the eagle owls. They quite like this weather. And of course, the eagle owls are after those little chaps. We're not going to keep the lights on them for too long, but just so you can see them. There we go, a little scrub hare running away. So we don't want to show all the eagle owls where he is. Well, we've had two wonderful little predator sightings this week, or in the last couple of days. We had that African wildcat the other night, and now the African civet. So, as I was saying, They're about the same size as a very big raccoon, and not related to raccoons, but you can see the markings can sort of lead you to believe that. Incredible omnivores. They eat fruits, little mammals, insects, arthropods. Strange enough, Jandra and I actually saw two during the day. So you heard Dave go, "Ah!" He just realized that he was wrong. So well done, Aaron. Oh, what was that? Sorry. Oh, I got sidetracked. So it was Aaron, Elaine, and Jeff who got it spot on. The largest country in Africa is indeed Algeria. Dave, I mean, they have to hit you with the geography stick. But from dangerous and tough, Dave Eastall on the back on camera, who is now freezing. He's got goosebumps all over his legs. He wants to be tough. And myself, we'll see you on the Sunrise Safari. Let's go across to James for the last few minutes of drive.
Well, that is very nice that you saw a civet, I must say. I have seen a rabbit since I last saw you. Well, not a rabbit, a hare. It ran away, obviously. Oh, and then I thought I saw a leopard. And Viam also thought we saw a leopard. It was sitting on a termite mound like this. Just the eyes shining off the top of a termite mound in exactly the manner you might expect a leopard's eyes to shine off a termite mound. Unfortunately, it was a duiker. So not a leopard at all, but a very small antelope. So I'm now going to say I'd really like to see an aardvark, because that's what Brent did, and that's got him a civet. So let's see. Maybe we'll be lucky. Aardvark, of course, means earth pig, and a wonderful word. First word in the English language, in the English dictionary normally, aardvark. Well, certainly was when the Black Adder wrote his version of it. Let's go around quarantine clearings to see if our aardvark is going to make an appearance. I've seen one civet since I've been here, and I find that increasingly strange because their tracks are all over the road every single morning. But not now. One of those late night animals, like Viam. Viam, you're a late night animal, aren't you? Used to be. Until you had to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, you mean? Yes. It's amazing. Well, come 9 o'clock, the camp is deathly quiet, except for last night when Rebecca was playing cards loudly outside my window till the wee hours. There is someone down there. Is that Brent again? Rebecca says she feels like the Russian and the American were louder than her. No, Rebecca, it was your joyful laughter that brought me from slumber repeatedly. That because it was so joyful, I didn't shout at you. Yes, no, lull. Yes, there's Brent, everybody. That's the only thing I've managed to find today. I'm not going to shine on him because he's diurnal. James Cole, you say perhaps Viam and I should sing Put a Banana in Your Ear, and maybe that will bring us luck for tomorrow. James Cole, I'm not sure I remember all the words to Put a Banana in Your Ear. Do you remember them, Viam?
That's Jandre's song.
It is Jandre's song a little. Put a banana in your ear. Put a ripe banana right into your very ear. It's true, so true. When you're down and feeling blue, just put a banana, put a banana, put a banana in your ear. I think that's how it goes. Thank you, James Cole.
I'll now expect prides of leopards to be leaping about, killing buffaloes, elephants chasing other elephants, possibly wild dogs. That's the kind of day we're going to have tomorrow. Very nice.